Something about the more global structure of the If we're going to analyze and we're going to read this paper by Farabaki, which represents kind of a simple mechanism for how you might get what we call power loss in them. Have genes that are usually activating the structure. What can you say about the structure? Now, you can analyze the global structure in a couple of different ways. One is just to ask about, how many different genes are different genes connected to? And that kind of makes it look more obvious. But then there was another major discovery that really alarmed the author of the textbook kind of thing, which is that you can ask in this crazy network that you have that describes the genes itself, are there kind of common patterns that appear over and over? So just like this idea of auto-regulation, that's something that appears frequently. You ask, why might that be? Similarly, if there are other patterns that appear in these networks, then maybe they arose in the Western form by evolution, because they perform some other function. In particular, we're going to analyze gene forward, where you have some gene that activates the sample, knows why. Why activates the sample? Now, if X again directly activates the receptor, then what does that do for you? This is something you see more frequently than you expect based on some notion of change from some goal loss, right? So the question is, why would these three forwards appear over and over again? It turns out that they can provide some nice function. For example, can provide a special response to temporary fluctuations, influence, etc. We'll try to get right, so as I alluded to before, this idea of the repressulator of microelements made, right, so we saw that it was surprisingly noisy. And this is what I'm thinking about, the role of stochastic fluctuation. I think that this is a common theme throughout much of the role of noise in biology. It could be within a cell, it could be a part of the development, how it is a body given noise. It could be at the level of evolutionary ecosystem that maybe noise actually plays a dominant role in, for example, determining abundance or diversity. And so we'll see these things kind of pop up on multiple scales. But in this case, what Ellowitz did, just a few years after his professor, he showed that if you just take a single cell, you give it the exact same instruction, right? So you say, all right, make a red protein, red blood protein, and make a green protein. And the exact same instruction. So, well, if you have the same instructions, then the level of the red and the green should kind of be the same thing. Right, but what he found is that actually there was a surprising heterogeneity of the level of those two proteins, even in single cells. The idea is that this represents a fundamental limit to what a cell can do, right? Because this is saying, that try to do the exact same thing at different times. If you don't get the same output, then that's a real limit to what you can do, right? Because you've done everything you can, right? You said, all right, sequence of that DNA, right? Exactly the same, yet you still get different outcomes. The question is, what's causing that? And also, how is it that life can actually function given this intrinsic noise? These are actually some images that you can so what you can see is that some of the cells are really rather red, some are rather yellow and green. So this is the color of the level. So now we have some notion. Okay, so somehow noise is important in molecular scale. Now, what I think is really quite a beautiful paper by Farabaki in 2006, where he combined single molecule fluorescence with live cells. This allowed him to observe kind of individual expression event and an individual cell. Right? For every time one of these proteins is expressed, we got a little yellow spot. Right? And so he was able to kind of watch it as real live cells